In this, our fourth and final week of our stewardship season, we encounter this last speech of Jesus in the 25th chapter of Matthew's Gospel. Most of you are aware that we are a Matthew 25 congregation and have been since the PCUSA began the initiative back in 2019. Our theme for stewardship this year is Flourishing Church, Seeking God's Shalom. And during these last few weeks, we've looked very closely at our roles as co-creators with God of the kingdom, of this expression of wholeness, of love and grace, of what theologian Neil Plantinga calls the webbing together of God's humans and creation in justice, fulfillment, and delight. Shalom means universal flourishing, wholeness, and delight, a rich state of affairs in which natural needs are satisfied and natural gifts are fruitfully employed. So our scripture today is the core text from which we draw our theme and the core text of the Matthew 25 initiative in the PCUSA, that familiar parable of the kingdom, the story of the sheep and the goats. The Reverend Diane Moffitt, president and executive director of the Presbyterian Mission Agency, said this about the text and its focus. She said, "Jesus' kingdom is not only a place you go to, but a place you come from. It's the kind of principles, the kind of teachings, it's the kind of radical inclusiveness and love and justice that Jesus demonstrates in his life. There's great joy in it because people are set free. So we're not just another social service agency. It's out of our faith that we do it." Jesus was political in nature. Of course, he was executed by the state, and it was because of the love, because of the truth. It was because of the systems that he was critiquing. Let's listen for God's word to us in Matthew 25, verses 31 through 46. Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. And all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? When was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those at his left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me, naked and you did not give me clothing, sick and in prison and you did not visit me.' Then they also will answer, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?' Then he will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Friends, I have a confession to make. Now, this is just between you and me and the 17 people who watch this on YouTube. Promise me that you won't be mad. In April of 2019, when the PCUSA first publicized Matthew 25 initiative, I signed us up. Turns out all the other good pastors took this to their session, you know, to vote on. We like that kind of thing. We Presbyterians decently and in order, don't you know? And I'm no stranger to our polity. I'm no fool. When we were first asked to host Youth Outlook in our building, as they were creating the Sterling Drop-In Center for LGBTQ plus youth, I did the Presbyterian thing. I asked questions, I did my research, I took it to a meeting and asked for a vote. When we joined the Covenant Network of Presbyterians last year, we signed on to the call to Covenant Community, joining in engaging the church to invite all of God's children into safe and welcoming congregational spaces of affirmation, healing, dignity, and purpose. Educating the church to expand our welcome of LGBTQIA plus people to affirm their gifts for ordained office and to uphold marriage equality for all. And equipping the church to bear witness to justice through advocacy and activism at the international, national, and local church levels, speaking a prophetic word in anxious and divided times, and standing with others in fighting hate and oppression against any of God's children. Friends, we voted on that. The session deliberated and voted because that's how we do things. But I just signed us up for Matthew 25 because obviously everybody's in favor of building congregational vitality and dismantling structural racism and eradicating systemic poverty, right? But here's an interesting thing I probably should have known. Apparently, for some congregations, signing up for Matthew 25 is a point of serious contention. I mean serious. I mean like church fights. There are some people who get really bent out of shape about this initiative. As I studied this scripture for today, I ran across a commentary in which the writer was discussing the question that the people ask, both sets of people, when did we see you? And he said, almost like a throwaway line, he said, the question, however, is simply an excuse for not doing anything. Well, it was an excuse for the goats. The sheep were unaware that they were serving Jesus, but they weren't not doing anything. They were being merciful. But what about those goats? Were they really asking that question as an excuse for doing nothing? Were they really blaming Jesus for not having revealed himself? Well, Jesus, if you'd have said something, how were we supposed to know? As I explored this question, I discovered something else that I felt like I probably should have known before now. People don't like talking about racism and poverty. I know people don't like talking about racism and poverty. I knew that, come on. But they don't like talking about it because talking about racism and poverty makes some people feel guilty. We feel guilty because we Christians on the topics of racism and poverty, maybe we can't say why, we just do. Maybe we remember some racist thing we said or did in the past and it was horrible and we feel bad about it. Maybe we feel a little bit selfish for not giving more. Then we try to feel better by saying or thinking, oh, we're all guilty. There isn't much we can do about it now. And we go, you know, do something charitable and try to smile at every person of color we see. Am I right? I'm saying this is true of me and maybe it's you too. But our collective guilt becomes an excuse for doing nothing because we say, well, we can't really do anything about it, and we're all guilty, so. And what King Jesus, sitting on that throne, wants from us is not guilt. Jesus is not interested in how guilty we feel. This parable is asking something else from us. It is asking us for collective responsibility. Collective responsibility means responding to needs, but it also means collective action. One writer describes it as a duty for individuals to take public stands about actions and events that affect broad masses of people, and to try to organize collective action to prevent massive harm or foster institutional change for the better. In Matthew 25, Jesus offered a critique not of individuals, but of nations and the systems they create and maintain. Diane Moffat said he's judging nations, how the nations treat people. The nations create systems that create access to food or not, access to clean water or not, access to shelter or not, or healthcare, to justice or not. Nations create or do not create that. It's a systemic approach in this scripture. It challenges us individually, but it speaks to nations and systems. So our call to stewardship extends all the way up the food chain to the systems of nations and kingdoms, and it extends all the way out to the edges of society, to the marginalized. And our call to stewardship is not just to feeling guilty and not just to charity, but to action for justice. Back in October, I went to visit my friend Kathy. She's been my friend since high school, and she lives in Atchison, Kansas. You may have seen my post on Facebook about this. A few years ago, Kathy's significant other, Scott Unruh, produced a documentary about John McClendon, a groundbreaking, trailblazing basketball coach who was mentored by Dr. James Naismith. That's the guy who invented basketball. Born in 1915 in Hiawatha, Kansas, McClendon first saw a basketball game when he was in high school, and he fell in love with the sport. He played basketball in junior college, and eventually he went to the University of Kansas, where Dr. Naismith was athletic director. Under Naismith's tutelage, McClendon learned the intricacies of the sport. But he never played for the Jayhawks. McClendon was black, and the University of Kansas did not integrate its team until 1951. John McClendon invented the fast break, the full court press, and the four corners offense. But the university wouldn't let him swim in the pool, even though a mandatory swimming test was required for his degree. Anyway, when I was in Kansas, Kathy and I went to a reception at the University of Kansas in the same building where the pool is, funnily enough, because John B. McClendon was being honored and recognized, and they were unveiling a plaque in his honor, and they were recognizing also that Scott Unruh had done this documentary. Y'all, I don't know squat about sports. So when Coach Bill Self opened the door for me and we chatted about the weather, I was like, oh, what a nice tall man. And I hadn't really paid any attention when my sister-in-law told me that her friend's son, Travis, was athletic director at the University of Kansas. And it still didn't click with me until after I heard what Travis Goff had to say about John McClendon. He talked about McClendon being a trailblazer, and then he said, and I quote, "I think trailblazers exist because of lofty, intentional, divisive, strategic barriers placed in front of them. And when you hear the stories we are reminded of today, I think it's important to remember we're right here at the University of Kansas honoring Coach McClendon, the same place that put intentional, divisive, strategic, lofty, incredibly challenging barriers in front of him." The Lawrence community did the same. Our society did that at the time. Goff went on to say, we have far from reached inclusive excellence at the University of Kansas and in society. I would challenge all of us to at least have some thought processes around the barriers that have been placed in our society and on our campuses for our young people, and in particular our young people of color from marginalized communities. Let's use this as an opportunity, as a catalyst, to not just think about removing barriers. It's not enough to remove barriers. It has to be more intentional. We have to fuel young people's opportunities ahead, and removing barriers isn't enough anymore. Let's be intentional. My new friend Travis from my hometown has it right. Let's be intentional. Let's be stewards of this gospel and do what Jesus asks of us intentionally and collectively. There are some things we can do on our own: giving generously, welcoming strangers, speaking up about racism, asking for and using people's pronouns. But mostly, if we're going to reach out to the marginalized and stand up for the oppressed, we have to do it together. As a flourishing congregation committed to seeking God's shalom. We may find ourselves out on the edges doing this because that's often where the people are whom God wants to reach. We may find that we have to take some risks, personally and as a church. But let's remember, we've done that before and we've always been blessed. In a short while, we will recognize the Youth Outlook group and hear from Carol Teal. And a little later, we're going to dedicate our pledges for 2022. And all this is part of who we are. People who take seriously the words of Jesus when he said, truly, I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these members of my family, you did it for me. Thanks be to God. Amen.